Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Bill Dugin. I'm the pastor here. I see some faces I don't know, which is always good, because you don't know me either, so that's a positive thing, right? Okay, just a joke. Thank you for coming, and we have the Adventist artist, painter, Nathan Green, his wife Patty as well, from probably not Bering Springs, but Eau Claire, Michigan. Fun fact, for my bachelor party, my father-in-law took me shooting with the Eau Claire Church. I don't know if that's where you attend, but it's a cool place, I have to say. So we are very honored, Mr. Green, to have you come, and thank you so much for taking the time to do this. So as we get started this afternoon, let's just please bow our heads for a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for Sabbath. We thank you for the opportunity that we have where we don't do the normal routine, where we can take the time and spend time in reflection on you and how wonderful you are. And now may that happen here as Mr. Green is presenting. Please bless him with your Holy Spirit and bless he and Patty as they're continuing their ministry. We invite your presence now. We need your presence now, we pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I want to start by thanking Callie and Bill for inviting Patty and I to come today. This is only the second time we've spoken and I've done a presentation since before COVID. So I may be a little rusty, it's really wonderful that you all came out to see us and to hear my stories. I'm going to be sharing with you tonight as if you were coming to my studio, which is separate from our home, about 6 miles away from our home, out in the country, a beautiful little spot where I work every day like a hermit. Most artists are kind of hermit-like, and I include myself in that classification. If you ever have a chance, we can't do this too often, but if you have a chance to happen to be in the Bering Springs area, which is 8 miles from where we live, look us up. We might be able to give you a tour of the studio. But I'm going to give you a virtual tour of the studio today. I'm going to start by discussing a little, just very briefly, my testimony, and mainly with the young people in mind, because when I was young, I grew up in an Adventist home. And my mother used to read to my brothers and I. I'm the youngest of three boys. She used to read stories to us from the Bible story series. And also, one of my favorite books was China Doctor. And that book made me want to be something that would help people in life. And so from a very early age, I thought I was going to be a doctor. But I had an obsession with drawing. Do any of you children here have an obsession with drawing or painting or art in general? I see some hands. Yes. People have asked me if I see any up-and-coming potential apprentices, and there could be one of you here. Who knows? So I started drawing from a very early age. My mother painted landscapes as a hobby, and I used to love to watch her paint. And when I was 4 or 5 years old, I would just sit behind her and watch the oil going on the canvas and smell the linseed oil and the pigments, and it made me want to be an artist. So fast forward to when I was 17 years old, and I was a student at Cedar Lake Academy, now known as Great Lakes Adventist Academy in Central Michigan. And somebody came to visit a student there who happened to know Harry and Ruth Anderson very well. And I'm just going to fast forward the... It's not advancing. I think I have it turned on. There we go. I did not do this painting. This was a painting by Harry Anderson. Do you mind if I get comfortable here? I'm realizing it's a little bit warm. Just a minute. So I knew of Harry Anderson's work when I was a teenager and when I was a young boy. I just didn't know who he was, didn't know him by name or anything. But this man thought that I would make a good apprentice for Harry Anderson. So he flew myself and Tom Turner, my art teacher from Cedar Lake, out to New York City, and we drove up to Connecticut to visit Harry Anderson. The apprenticeship didn't work out because he was a very shy, reserved man, more of a hermit than I am. But we became friends. He gave me advice then that had a significant influence on my future. We met numerous times over the year, and I'll talk to you a little bit more about that later. But what I want to tell you is the next day that I came back home to Michigan, I was sitting on the campus at Cedar Lake, and I was sitting with a friend of mine. They were asking me what I had experienced in New York and Connecticut. And as I was explaining my meeting with Harry Anderson, I suddenly had this incredible feeling, like the Holy Spirit surrounding me. And I don't know if that's what it was or if it was just because I was so ecstatic about having experienced what I did. But I'm convinced to this day that it was God's Spirit. And I told my friend, I don't know what it is, but I have the feeling meeting Harry Anderson has something to do with my future and God's plan for me. Little did I know. Fast forward a few years, and I was a student at Andrews University. I was actually a pre-med student because I still wanted to be a doctor. But I was an art minor, a pre-med major. I loved the pre-med program at Andrews University. But the art world at that time was very much the modern art movement had influenced, and you might even say corrupted in some ways, art programs across the country. So it was very, very hard to find any art school that taught traditional techniques and methods. Traditional academic skills were considered a hindrance to creativity at that time. There's been a resurgence in realism since then, but at that time in the early 80s, it was a different story. So it was actually on an art field trip from Andrews to Chicago that I discovered the American Academy of Art. And I came back to my dorm room at Andrews. I called my parents. I'm thankful for very understanding parents because they didn't, you know, I called them and told them, I'm going to quit Andrews. I'm coming home, packing my stuff. They didn't say, you can't be an artist. You know, you're not going to make a living. Be a doctor. You'll make a living, you know. None of that. They said, wonderful. If that's what you want to do, that's what you should do. So I came home. I worked for a year for a beekeeper up in Cedar Lake. Got stung amply. In fact, my brother went into beekeeping, and he offered for me to go into business with him. But one night, we were moving bees in pollination. We'd worked all day and then worked all night moving bees in pollination. And in an apple orchard in southwestern Michigan, several stacks of bees fell off the load when we hit a pothole, and we had to clean all that up. When I got back in the truck, I counted 42 stingers that had worked between my buttons, and about 100 stings altogether when you think of all the different wrists and ankles. And Wesley looked over, my older brother Wesley looked at me, and he kind of grinned and said, so you want to go into business with me? I said, I'm going to art school, Wes. And that's what I did. And you know, the first day I went to art school, I had to show my portfolio to the president of the American Academy of Art. And he seemed to like my work. It was high school work, you know, and a little bit of college cartooning. And we were talking, and he asked me what I wanted to do as a career, and I looked up on the wall, and there was an illustration by Harry Anderson. Not one that he had done for the Adventist Church. He was one of the top illustrators in the country back in the 1930s through the 60s. And it was a Ladies' Home Journal illustration. And I told him, or Shapiro was the president, I said, I think I'm going to do what Harry Anderson did. We ended up having a conversation about Harry Anderson's career. But once again, I had that same feeling of the Holy Spirit with me. And I've experienced that about three or four times in my life, each at times when it seemed to me like God was confirming to me the path he had in mind for me. So I'm going to start this presentation. Maybe we can turn all the lights off. And you'll notice the tie-in with Harry Anderson several times during this presentation. And at the conclusion, I want to leave you with a challenge. But we'll get to that in a few minutes. I started my career in Chicago. So actually, Chicago was home for me for a number of years, both attending the American Academy of Art downtown. And Patty and I, when she finished dietetics at Andrews, we moved to Hinsdale, and she was a dietitian there for 3 years. And I started my career at many of the publishers in Chicago, like World Book Encyclopedia, Christianity Today, Tyndale House, Scripture Press, then Billy Graham, Focus on the Family. Eventually, I took a trip out to the East Coast and started working for NASA and National Wildlife, Ranger Rick magazine, various publishers that, like National Geographic, I interviewed there. And just started getting some calls and from them when some bigger opportunities came along. But this is an illustration for Focus on the Family magazine. Oops. This was a cover for Signs of the Times magazine. And it was, I've skipped a lot of the illustrations from the early days because they're really not that great. In fact, I have a hard time believing that publishers kept hiring me, but they did. And it gave me a lot of training, a lot of learning you have on the job. And I'm sure any career is probably like that. But this was one of the first times that I portrayed Jesus in an illustration. And it led to many more opportunities. It led to what I do today. So this was in the 1980s, a cover for Signs of the Times called Jesus Was No Wimp. Because he was a carpenter. He walked everywhere. He was, you know, probably a physically strong man. There's an interesting story about this particular cover. We got a message through the editor of Signs of the Times saying that there's a street ministry in New York City and the van ministry there. They had a display out on the sidewalk, and this was probably 1987, 88, and there was a group of young people that came by, and they were really rough, a rough crowd, and they were kind of mocking their people and jeering a little bit. But there was a teenage girl in the group who stopped and came back as the others went on. And she looked at this magazine cover for like a minute or two. And she said, wow, if this is what Jesus is like, I'm interested. And she said, can I have this? And they said, of course you can have this. That's what it's here for. So I loved, that was one of the first times that I got some feedback from a publisher or an editor telling me that what I do in my work can touch people. And not just for aesthetic pleasure, but for potentially eternal influence. And that really thrilled me and caused me to want to do more of that type of work. This was an illustration for Signs of the Times magazine, Christmas time. I actually pose real people. So if you ever come to my studio, you'll see that I have photography equipment. I have, usually when I'm working on a job, I'll have prints out on the table, photos that I've taken of models. Norman Rockwell used to say, spare the prop, spoil the picture, or spare the model, spoil the picture. We don't actually think of these things. We think of the idea in our mind, but to make it to a level of realism, we have to find models that will work and something that we can render light and perspective and all that. In fact, if you notice me looking at you a little longer than I should, I'm not strange. You just might be being scoped out as a potential model. And you're only 3.5 hours away from my studio, so it's a realistic possibility. This girl was 16 years old, Sylvia Canali. Some of you might know her, actually. And the little baby was only 4 days old and weighed 4.5 pounds. And you just know that if you set a baby like that in a girl's arms, she's going to have a look of love and compassion in her eyes, and Sylvia did. By the way, just to show you how things get reused. This was originally for Signs of the Times. Billy Graham magazine picked it up and put it on the cover of Decision magazine. The Salvation Army used it on the cover of The War Cry, I think is their magazine. It's been used multiple times by different publishers. There we go. I mentioned National Wildlife and Ranger Rick. This is an illustration for Ranger Rick magazine. And I used to love it when the art director from Ranger Rick called me. This wasn't my main purpose as an illustrator. That became more and more spiritual in nature as time went on. But I grew up with Ranger Rick. My parents subscribed to this magazine for my brothers and I when we were boys, and I loved the magazine. And whenever I got, I think I did about 5 different assignments for them. This is one of them. This is another for Ranger Rick, about a girl who falls in a pond and comes up with a handful of salamander eggs. So it's a chance to teach children about the life cycle of salamanders. I mentioned NASA. Back in the late 80s and early 90s, I worked for the NASA art program for about 3 or 4 years, doing assignments. I would cover launches, landings, astronaut training, things like that. This was the deployment of the Gamma Ray Observatory. I wasn't actually there to take the reference shots for this painting. The astronauts took pictures of the GRO, they called it. The Gamma Ray Observatory was one of the first 4 great observatories: Hubble for visible light, gamma ray for gamma rays, ultraviolet, and X-ray. All of them are, well, I think Hubble might still, I'm not sure if it's in operation, but the Webb telescope has taken its place. Gamma Ray Observatory is space junk now, but this is underwater training at Huntsville, Alabama, Marshall Space Flight Center. You can see a scuba diver there. They have a complete orbiter bay submerged in a tank. They also have a similar tank down at Johnson Space Flight Center. And they practice everything there. Everything they're going to do in space, they practice in this underwater environment. This is just after the landing of the shuttle Endeavour. This Endeavour was built to replace Challenger after the Challenger accident. This was its first flight. And I was actually on the runway at Dryden, Edwards Air Force Base, just 200 yards off the runway when it landed. And they gave me permission to sit or stand in the boom, the crow's nest of a big boom arm called the Condor. And you actually, no, you can't see it in here, but it's used to plug the vent holes and do higher level work when the shuttles landed. After the astronauts left, they actually gave me permission to go on board. And there's a picture in a moment of me grinning in the commander's seat here. This is the Gamma Ray Observatory in a way that they used it in a commercial purpose. And that's me sitting in the commander's seat 1 hour after it had been in orbit. This was before 9/11 and when security, I mean, I was thoroughly checked for security, but things were more relaxed in those days. By the way, there's a humorous story about this. You see, I have a white jumpsuit on. Everybody in the ground crew had to wear these suits for dirt and dust control. And the guy that was taking me through the shuttle, there were still workers in there cleaning out laundry and debris and stuff. And he said, here, give me your camera, I'll take a picture. And so I took the lens cap off, handed him the camera, made a few adjustments, handed him the camera, and sat in the commander's seat. I put the lens cap in the pocket of my jumpsuit. And when I got out of the shuttle, I reached my lens cap, and there's no lens cap. There's no pocket. It's a fake pocket. So I knew that it landed on the floor somewhere in the shuttle, and I immediately had visions, headline news, shuttle crash blamed on lens cap, stuck in throttle controls or something like that, you know? And so I had to sheepishly go back and ask them to find it, and they did. So it was about the same time that I was working for NASA and enjoying that work. And having fun, but I was doing about 50 to 60 book and magazine illustrations a year, and it was about 8 or 9 years into my career. I've been doing this for 40 years now. This year is about the 40th year. And I was looking for something more significant to do. It was about that time that Mark Finley became Speaker of It Is Written, and he asked me to do an illustration for the broadcast It Is Written that was used for many years. This is it. It's called The Invitation. It was a 3x4 horizontal format to fit television. They gave me a precise list of colors that do and do not work for TV. And you'll notice, any of you art students will notice there's an interesting dynamic here. Two colors that are opposite on the color wheel. So they're complementary colors, golden yellow and violet. They're opposite of each other. And I believe in the right hue, they create kind of a vibrance and a visual excitement. And that's why those colors are in this painting. But there's symbolism in this too. The Rose of Sharon, the Lily of the Valley, flowers that represent Jesus. Now, I mentioned that I had been doing many illustrations a year, and I used to tell my friends that printing presses wait for no man. There's always deadlines, always pressure. We were starting to raise a family, and doing all-nighters wasn't working as well for me as it used to. And so I call it my hour-long prayer. I was out running. I used to run a lot, and I was out running one day, and I was praying that God would give me an opportunity to do something more significant than a book or a magazine illustration, but to do something like in a large oil painting format. Because my ability in oil painting was improving, and I thought, I can do this now. Just give me an opportunity. And it wasn't but a few months later that I got a call from VersaCare Corporation. They happen to own two hospitals, two Adventist hospitals, Corona Hospital in California and Hialeah Hospital down near Miami. And they said, we called Harry Anderson and asked him if he would do these two paintings. He said, well, I'm retired. Call Nathan Green. He'll do a good job for you. So round circle, you know, I had probably met with Harry 5 or 6 times during that time. One of the previous meetings to this, he gave me his costume collection. And I brought some of those with me today. In fact, at the end of the program, I'll share some of those with you, and you'll probably recognize some. So one of those two commissions was this painting. It's called Chief of the Medical Staff, Christ Guiding a Surgeon's Hand. This was originally intended for the Surgeon's Lounge at Hialeah Hospital in Florida to encourage the surgeons, but they quickly realized that the patients that came through the hospital were sometimes profoundly influenced by this image. In fact, Florida Hospital for many years and its satellite hospitals would give a postcard or a greeting or a get well card to every surgical patient that came through their doors. One of those stories I heard back came back to me. It was that a woman had a brain tumor. She was going in for this surgery, a very serious surgery, and somebody gave her this card. And she was a believer, she was a Christian. It meant so much to her to see that image. It comforted her. So much so that she clutched that card as she was being rolled into the operating theater. The anesthesiologist said she remained clutching it even under anesthesia. I don't know how that could be, but she did. And as she was rolled out, she was still holding onto that card. In recovery, she was still holding onto that card. And I got word back from her and her family how much it meant to them. And when I heard that, I suddenly had this kind of a epiphany, you might say. I realized that work that I once thought was my ultimate goal and ambition, like National Geographic or NASA or National Wildlife, those are things I wanted to do, but they don't have the potential to influence and inspire people for eternity. And that, to me, is far more satisfying, deeply satisfying, than just doing something to tell a story or sell a product or just something for aesthetic enjoyment, which all has its place and all has its value. And you have to make a living as an artist. It's not easy to do that. So I did whatever I needed to do as an illustrator. But when I got that message, I knew that's what I wanted to do. And so once this painting and the next painting, once they were published, my career changed almost overnight. I went from doing 50 or 60 book and magazine illustrations a year to doing about 2 to 3, sometimes only one painting per year, large oil paintings. This is called The Family of God. And this, you know, I lived near Andrews University for the last 36 years when we moved away from Chicago. One of the reasons was the photographer I work with, Dave Sherwin. But the other reason is that there's about 100 different countries represented in the student body at Andrews University. And what a model pool for an Adventist artist. And as I've become better known, it's easier to ask them to come model. You know, it was always awkward at first. Can you bring your children to my studio so I can take pictures of them? You know how the world is today. It didn't always, you know, they look at you funny. Can I trust you? But it's just wonderful, and knowing who I am really helps. If I'm too shy to ask people to model for me, my wife is not. She'll go right up to people in the grocery store and ask them, you know, and I really appreciated that. That little blonde-haired boy in the foreground, that's our son Tommy. And he was 18 months at the time. He's now 33, and he's married to Lauren Pop. And the Pop family is very close to the Dameron family. In fact, we'll get a little into that later, but Don and Elise Dameron, parents of Callie, they're good friends of ours and been very close to the Pop family for a long time. Doug just had a brain tumor removed through surgery about a week or a week and a half ago. So your prayers for him, I'm sure, would be greatly appreciated. But their daughter married our son, and now they have a little girl named Kit, who you'll see at the very end here. Now, I neglected to mention that about 32 years ago, a man named Dan Houghton, who is well-known in Adventist church circles, became my agent and my publisher. And I was telling him one day, in fact, Dan and Karen got married in this church more than 40 years ago. Some of you may know them. I think her name was Karen Samanda, Samanda. Anyways, I told Dan once that I'd like to do some paintings that I have an interest in doing, not just something that I've been commissioned to do. And he asked me, well, what would you like to do? I said, well, my father-in-law is a sheep farmer. He raises Suffolk sheep. And when Suffolk sheep are babies, they're black. And as they mature, their head and legs remain black, but their body becomes kind of a malt-o-meal color. And I told him, I've never seen a picture of Jesus holding a black lamb or a black sheep. And the significance, the symbolism seems profound to me. I'd like to do a painting of Jesus with a black lamb. So he commissioned this, the publisher did. And it's become one of the most popular images that I've done as far as prints and postcards and such. So that's a little baby Suffolk lamb. And it's called The Lamb of God. There's been five in the series since then. This is called The Good Shepherd. This is called The Rescue. And this is a watercolor. And this, people often ask me which of my illustrations is my favorite. And there's some that I wish weren't out there. But this is probably one of my favorites here, one of two or three. And a few years back, I wanted to do some paintings of great women in the Bible. And this was the first. This is Mary and Martha with Jesus. The dresses that the women are wearing are actually Bedouin, Palestinian Bedouin dresses that I borrowed from the archaeology department at Andrews. Now, 6 years ago, Patty and I took a trip to Israel and to Jordan ourselves, and I came back with probably about 12 of these dresses to use for future projects, and I brought two of them with me today. So everything is very authentic in here. The dresses, though, we don't know if they had that kind of needlework back in the day, but the pottery I borrowed from the Archaeology Museum, and it's actually 2,000-year-old pottery. They put it in a cardboard box, and I drive home with it, and I feel like, I can't believe they're letting me do this, you know, but fortunately, I haven't broken anything yet. So everything's authentic except the pocket bread the man in the foreground is holding. That's from Schrader Market. This is called Story Time, and this is kind of a funny thing because it was actually commissioned by a physician we met at Focus on the Family years ago. His wife was, and probably still is, a teacher of kindergarten and first grade students at a Christian school in Illinois. And I actually went undercover. I was pretending. He didn't want her to know about the commission. And I pretended to be a photographer, and the staff knew about why I was there, but they didn't tell her. And so all day, well, probably 3 or 4 hours, I was with them. What my point was to find a moment in their day that would be a great scene to paint. And when we came upon the time when she read stories to them, I knew this was it, you know, because they all gather around sitting on the floor. The thing is, this was in the middle of winter, and a fire alarm went off while we were in the middle of this experience. And it was cold outside, and it was a real fire in the kitchen. Didn't turn out to be serious, but so picture this. There's about 600 children out in below freezing temperatures, didn't have a chance to grab their coats or anything. And somebody got the bright idea of putting everybody in the minivans and the SUVs and stuff, and I had my Ford Explorer. So if you can imagine me sitting in my Ford Explorer, the teacher sitting next to me, a dozen students jumping around in the back seat, and she starts asking me questions about my career as a photographer. She thinks I'm a commercial photographer. And my mama told me not to lie. So that night, I got a call from her husband, and he asked me how it went. And I said, well, the ice got pretty thin there for a while. And he just laughed. I said, did you think she suspected anything? And he said, well, she did say he was kind of funny, whatever that means. But this is called The Lion and the Lamb. And I'm going to give you a little art lesson, especially for you children who expressed an interest in art. Or those of you, any of you, we're all children, right? Everything about this painting is designed to manipulate the viewer's eye. You didn't know that. When you look at a painting, you're often being manipulated. But everything is designed to draw your attention to the focal point, which, of course, is, let's see if I can use this pointer, is this area right here. The contrast between the blue and the white. Of course, the lion's face draws your attention in. But notice that this wedge here points that way. The children, everybody is looking that way. These children are running that way. This lamb is leaning that way. Even the tail of the lion curls back around and points you back to the focal point. So everything, even the clouds, the sweep of the clouds. I don't always do it that obviously, but this is a good example of that. This was actually commissioned by a man who owned the largest retirement home network in the world. An Adventist man, Bill Colson. And he told me that elderly people like to watch children at play. And so let's do a painting of children at play. And this has been used in many different ways as well, but it was a great deal of fun to paint. The lion actually was from a photograph from a Time Life photographer who had passed away 30 years before, but his wife gave me permission to use it. The trouble was, it was actually a lion in Africa. It was under the shade. It had flies on its face, and the paws were cropped off in the picture. So I had to study other pictures of lion's paws. I actually studied our own cat's paws to get an idea of what these paws, because they were the same thing, just on a different scale. By the way, that lamb was from my father-in-law's sheep farm as well. This is, years later, a sequel to that painting. This is called The Lord God Made Them All. And one of the first times I've painted marine wildlife. This is actually a portrait commission for Don and Esther Latour, their children's Donnie and Joshua. And they're now, Donnie just graduated from Loma Linda as a physician, and Joshua is, I think, almost graduated. That's them right there, Donnie and Joshua. And that's our son, Daniel. He's all grown up and married now, too. It's just amazing how time flies. But Don Latour likes to say, imagine that we're all in heaven now, and Jesus comes to a group of children and says, follow me, come see this, you know, because dolphins are so incredible. I mean, they're so intelligent, their brains are bigger than ours, and wouldn't it be just like him to, you know, call them up for the children to see close up? This is called I Am With You Always, and this is our daughter Bonnie sleeping in the bed, and a little humorous story to tell with this one. The model that I use for Jesus, I've used two over the years, and this is the second one early on when I first started modeling him. When I bring him up from Miami, he's a professional fashion model, it costs about $3,500 for the day to bring him up. So I try to think of everything I can possibly pose him for while he's here. Maybe I overwork him a little bit, but partway through the afternoon, you know, he had just been posing with my daughter Bonnie, who's probably five or so at this time. And he stood up and he came over to me and said, do you mind if I take a break? I'm going to go out and smoke a cigarette. And I said, sure. You know. So he's lighting up a cigarette and heading out the door. And my daughter looked up at me and she said, Jesus smokes? And I'm telling you the truth. Every night, my wife and I would take turns going in and praying with each of our children, usually telling stories and talking and then praying to say goodnight. And every night, for probably 2 years or so, Bonnie prayed for Manny that he would quit smoking. And years later, like 20 years later, he was up for another photo shoot just a couple of years ago. And I decided I was going to tell him the story because he's got a great sense of humor. And I told him what had happened. He just laughed and laughed. He said, you know, I did quit smoking. took me about 5 years, but I did quit smoking. I knew it would affect my modeling career, and so I did. So maybe her prayers made a difference. I don't know. This is a sequel to that called Night Watch, of a little boy sleeping. And those stuff, that's not our son Daniel, but that's, he was about the right age, but those are all his stuff's toys. He liked eclectic toys, dinosaurs and iguanas and things like that. So we used to, you know, any of you parents of young children would know what this is like. We sometimes would play musical beds at night. You know, I'd hear Daniel come in, he's probably 3 years old, and you hear pad, 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 and you feel him climbing up in bed. And of course, he would snuggle up to Patty, but his feet would be pushing on me. And after a while, I would say, okay, I'm giving up. So I'd go into his room, you know, find the empty bed, walk across the floor in bare feet, stepping on Legos and various, you know, clanking toys. And I'd slide into the covers, and all these Legos would fall off the bed and coins. And I'd just get nestled. This really happened. I'd just get nestled in, stretch out, and my foot pressed against a Tickle Me Elmo. Yeah, you know. Now, I mentioned our son Tommy married Lauren Pop, a good friend of the Dameron family, and that is Lauren. And ever since appearing, that's Warren Pop, the grandpa who passed away several years ago, that's Lauren's grandpa. And I posed this in the ICU of Lakeland Hospital in St. Joseph, Michigan. And I knew that they would pose well together because they all really loved each other. So the compassion on Lauren's face is genuine. And actually, Warren had been in the ICU a few years before, having had a cardiac arrest. And so he was busy chatting about his experience there. He was very talkative. But so we had to kind of tell him to simmer down. We need you to pretend like you're sick now, okay, Warren? But it was a great experience. And ever since this has been published, Lauren has gotten many comments. I didn't know you were a nurse. She's not. She and my son are both graphic designers. One of my jobs as an illustrator is I wanted to update evangelistic art for the World Church, and this, I'm going to show you a couple examples of that. This is called Light of the World, and this is Ever Interceding. The idea, the concept of Christ praying for all of humanity. And it bears a resemblance to Gethsemane, Jesus in Gethsemane, doesn't it? That was intentional. The four horsemen of Revelation. I didn't bring it with me, but sometimes I bring the fourth horseman, which represented death and pestilence. Sometimes I bring the costume and the helmet for children to wear, but I didn't want to spook anybody out. It's kind of sinister looking. Now I want to give you a little virtual tour of my studio here. This is actually a picture from a few years ago. The landscaping has grown up a little bit since then. But if you're coming to, it's out in the country in the midst of apple orchards. This is my dog, Peach Pit. She's my apprentice. My daughter brought her to me one day without asking. She was volunteering. She was an animal science major, and she was volunteering at the dog pound walking dogs. And she came in one day, and this dog had a note on its cage to be put down that day because she was pit bull or part pit bull. And Bonnie knew that she was a sweet dog, so she begged them not to put her down, but they don't adopt out or didn't adopt out anything that was pit bull. So she begged them and begged them, and finally they relented, and she didn't ask. I taught my children unintentionally that it's easier to ask forgiveness than permission. And this is one of those examples. Her boyfriend had the dog in the apartment for most of the day. Then they brought it to me, thinking that I might be an easier pushover than my wife. And they were right. And Peach Pit has been, I've had golden retrievers and an Irish setter and a husky, and Peach Pit, this mixed breed mutt, has been the best dog I've ever had. I've had her now for almost 11 years. Now I want to show you a little slideshow with music. This is the production of a painting called A New Birth of Freedom. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about it after we watch this.
Sound?
Supposed to be sound. There we go. Now that was about 9 months worth of painting compressed into 4 or 5 minutes. But that was a depiction of Lincoln being brought to Richmond, the Confederate capital, just a day and a half after the Confederates fled, the government and army fled Richmond. It was still on fire in the warehouse district. It wasn't fully secure when Admiral David Dixon Porter and 12 sailors and three other officers brought Abraham Lincoln and his son Tad to Richmond. And it was kind of a risky thing to bring Lincoln there that day, but Lincoln wanted to bring the South back into the fold and the family as soon as possible. and he didn't want to have retribution or anything evil done to the Southerners. And quite a moving moment. He was assassinated 10 days after this, and you need to bear in mind that minutes after this group of newly freed slaves greeted him at the harbor, hundreds and then thousands of them lined the streets to greet him and to thank him for their freedom. And he was assassinated 10 days later. It was a very significant moment in American history that most people are not even aware of, because it's not been depicted much, it's not been told about very much. But there were 6 journal accounts from people that were there that I could base this painting on. And I also was able to download artwork or a photography from the Library of Congress that was taken 5 days after Lincoln was there. Now, that man who posed for Abraham Lincoln is Kelly's grandfather, Chet Dameron. And I wish he was still around. because he was a fantastic man and a fantastic model for Lincoln. In fact, he was a member of a group of reenactors of Lincoln, and I think he was the best of the bunch, and he was also their chaplain. My wife Patty worked for Chet back when she and I were in college at Andrews. This was over 40 years ago, and so we've known him for a long time, but not as long as Don and Elise and Kelly. And after we finish, we're not quite finished yet, but I'm going to invite people up to try on some costumes, and you're going to see the costume modeled by Don that we had made specially for Chet Dameron to wear, and a few other costumes from that painting. Now I'm going to show you to explain a little bit, because that slideshow doesn't really explain what's happening, but I start every painting with photography and research and photographing models, of which you saw a layout of some of those model references on my table. This is another painting, The Resurrection of Christ, that I did in the same manner. I do a drawing, very elaborate drawing, pencil drawing first, then I transfer that to canvas, then I do an underpainting, which is that very abstract painting you saw first. This looks like I'm a modern artist, and it looks very abstract, but believe it or not, it's very methodically planned out ahead of time. And so this is what it looks like after I've done the underwash and pulled out some of the lighter values with a brush and paint thinner. That process often takes 14 to 18, sometimes 20 hours. So I still do pull all-nighters occasionally, but I'm 62 years old now and I can't do that much longer. So this is part of that process. The colors that's my friend. Peach is just wonderful. And then I start painting in the traditional manner, opaque oil paint brush strokes, and that's what takes the time. The oil wash and the drawing just takes a very brief amount of time, but the traditional painting, a long time. My approach is very much like Norman Rockwell's approach. In fact, I never knew him personally. Harry Anderson did. They were friends, and we talked about Rockwell, but I learned about his approach from his own autobiography. These soldiers are all people that I knew. We meet at Andrews or at churches nearby. In fact, I'm embarrassed to say sometimes Patty and I go visit other churches like Pioneer Memorial Church, and we're really not there to hear the sermon. By the end of the sermon, Patty's like, okay, you take that one, I'll take this one. We follow people out the door. So I feel a little guilty about that, but you know. And these shots are over time. This painting probably took about 4 months to paint, I think. I thought it'd be really neat to show the angel who rolled away the stone, putting on the tunic and robe on Jesus, particularly the outer robe. Nobody ever thinks about that, but you know, when a man was buried, he wore nothing but a linen cloth wrapped around him, and that was left at the tomb, as the Gospels say. So, did he miraculously have a tunic and robe appear? Wouldn't it be neat if Gabriel, who we believe it was Gabriel who rolled that stone away, also dressed him in the tunic and robe? So that I had to imagine how to depict an angel and his face, and I modeled about 5 or 6 people. None of them quite looked angelic enough, so I invented a face based on many different references to make the angel. I'm pressing the button. Well, you get a really good look at the face. There we go. You're just drawn back a little bit. and close up. So people often say that my photography or my paintings look photographic, which I know they mean it as a compliment, but I like the idea that there's some painterliness to it, and this close-up kind of shows some of that painterliness, I hope. There is the completed painting, and my dog Peachpin and I, we have a new tradition, we howl after every painting is finished, because I feel like howling when a painting is finished, and if I howl, she howls, believe me. I want to share with you just a couple of neat things. Every now and then I get feedback about how the artwork is received around the world. We made a deal with Garwin McNeilis a few years back. They were building one-day schoolhouses to be assembled all around the world, Africa, South America. And in, I believe it was Ghana, Africa, they assembled about 9 of them, I believe, for a school there. And the local king, I think he would be called a king, donated the land to the Adventist church. And then they had a grand opening for the occasion when it was all ready and done. And what the deal we made with Garwin is to put 4 of my paintings on steel plates, just like truckers' decals that are almost indestructible, on steel plates that would be in each of these schoolhouses. And their plan originally was to make about 5,000 of these schoolhouses around the world. I don't know if they've achieved that yet, but so this is the grand ceremony, the grand opening of this school. And the chief was, this is one of my favorite photographs. I usually ask people to send photos to me. This was the chief from the area, chief or king, I'm not sure. He was so pleased, not only with the artwork, but the buildings and how it was going to be used, that he donated more land after this to expand the Adventist educational presence there and church presence there in Ghana. Now, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about this painting. I brought a large copy of this called The Blessed Hope. I did this painting, let me back up a little bit. I was with Mark Finley. We have worked together many times since we first started when he became Speaker of It Is Written. And we were at a ministerial conference in Tucson about 14 years ago. And I asked him, Mark, if there's one thing I could do as an Adventist artist to contribute something important to our church, what would it be? And without skipping a beat, he said, a new painting of the Second Coming, one that's ethnically diverse. And I said, okay, I'm willing to do that. And I told him how much time I thought it would take and what it would cost, and he didn't bat an eyelash. And he said, I'll find the funding. And 2 years later, within months, I got the funding. I started the project. It took a year to paint. The original is at the General Conference headquarters in Silver Springs. It's with the frame. It's 9 feet wide by 6.5 feet tall. And it took about a year to paint. It was to be unveiled at the Atlanta General Conference session. And I was still painting it right up to the last weekend. And I called Mark and I said, you know, I've been working, you know, like 18-hour days, and it still wasn't done. And I called Mark and said, I'm so sorry. I know it's supposed to be unveiled, but it's just not done. I've been doing the best I can. He said, just bring it down. We'll unveil it anyways. We won't say a thing. We'll just unveil it. So we did. And I only had 2 people come up to me after it was unveiled in the big stadium there, and said, that's not finished, is it? And they were artist friends of mine. Either nobody else noticed or nobody else would tell me, but my artists are not afraid to tell me, you know. But it was just some of the horizon and the city in the background that weren't finished. But there are many things in this painting that most people aren't aware of unless they get some of the inside story. And let me just share a few things with you. These are all people that I know, and probably some of them are people you know. There was a girl in the audience here who said her grandpa modeled for this, and I believe he is right there. This is a little fuzzy, so it's a little hard to say to tell from this. The original, I mean, this copy here, you can come up afterwards and take a closer look. This couple here, these are good friends of ours, David and Carrie Grellman. They were missionaries in Sierra Leone. They came home because their daughter, Christy, was ill. She was diagnosed with neuroblastoma, and we knew them very well, and we watched Christy as she went through her illness, and I can see somebody crying, and maybe you want to cry too. She was 4.5 when she passed away. And I did a painting of her posthumously for David and Carrie 2 years after she passed. And our daughter was very similar in age, so I posed Bonnie for her lower body and pictures of Christy from birthday parties and things for the upper body. And she's holding a white kitty snowball that they bought for her when she was going through treatments. And Jesus is kneeling beside her, petting the little white kitty. But when I had an opportunity to do a picture of the resurrection scene, what better chance than to encourage her parents that they'll see her again. Death is a temporary problem. Even we all know that. But sometimes we need to be reminded. And for me, spending a month painting a scene of the resurrection was a profound reminder for me that this is just not just theoretical or legend or myth. This is real, that this really will happen. And nothing can create more intimacy with the subject and the meaning behind it than painting it day after day after day. There's also this couple here receiving this child. They're friends of ours who had gone through several miscarriages. And my wife and I, our first pregnancy was a miscarry. And I know, especially from the mother's experience, how that can be very emotional and very draining and difficult. And I believe it was Ellen White in her writing said that parents will be given a chance to raise those young children again. Now, some people may not believe that, but I think it would be just like God to allow such a thing. This family right here, this is Corey Bush. He's a builder. He's a friend of mine from Berrien Springs. And that's his daughters, Noe and Maddie. And I had posed their whole family. And at that time, their son, Colton, Patty and I were teaching in the juniors class at Eau Claire. He was one of our students. He was about 10 years old. And he came in one day knowing I was painting this, and he said, "Mr. Green, did you put our family in the painting yet?" And I said, "Well, I put some of you in." I knew I was kind of on shaky ground because I didn't put him in. And I said, "Well, I put some of them in." And he said, "Well, who did you put in and who did you leave out?" And I thought, And I said, "Well, I put your dad in and I put your two sisters in, but I didn't put your mom and you in." And I was going to explain why, but he started crying. And I said, "Oh, I'm so sorry, you know." And he said, "You didn't put my mom in?" He didn't care that he wasn't in it. He thought that if his mom wasn't in the painting, she wasn't maybe going to heaven. And he laughs about it now. He's a young man and a very, you know, macho, strong young guy, but very sweet still. But yeah, those decisions sometimes have to be made. And all mothers should have warmed hearts hearing such a tale. There are people from all over the country represented here. Most of them are from Andes University. And of course, you would never see a group wearing their native dress from all over the world and together. So there's a bit of symbolism involved in this, but we believe the second coming will be a literal, audible, visual thing for the whole world. And so this is ultimately not symbolic. But I want to show you my favorite character in this whole thing is this little girl right here. She's from Korea. And I asked Patty to contact some Korean mothers at Andrews because they're often coming to go to the seminary. And she talked to a mother, and she asked, "How many do you want?" She said about 6, because that's what I'd asked for. And their dress is just beautiful, brilliant, bright colors. Well, when they came, there was maybe 5 or 6 mothers and about 2 dozen children, and most of them did not speak English. And so it was kind of a wild photo shoot, and I'm standing on a ladder to get a high perspective, you know, and after a while, I'm starting to get a little stressed trying to communicate. So let's take a break. And so everybody went off to the side, and this little girl holding this banner just started just spontaneously spinning around, just joyous look on her face. So I just stood up there, click, 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 and she just looked so beautiful and not posed like anyone else there, just natural, spontaneous joy, which I think a lot of people will experience at the second coming. And so I cleared the area around here. There's nobody standing in her way or covering her up. She has her own little spot there on the ledge. So there are many other stories here. The angels are only about 12 different guys who my son Tommy and I posed together. We had them on a table, on a piano bench, pretending to be flying. We had a fan blowing so that their garments were blowing in the wind. And the wings are all from photographs of swans and cranes and whooping cranes and stuff. There's a close-up of Christy being reunited with her parents, David and Carrie. Close-up of the baby being reunited with her his parents. There's my little Korean girl. Corey and Maddie and I didn't mention this girl. She's my only representative from China, and she's Carol Beale. She was adopted by a family that goes to Stevensville Church, and she's all grown up now. This was about 12 years ago. But when you look at the painting, I'm not sure if I included this here. Just a minute. She is right all by herself looking up at Jesus, and it almost looks, when you look close at the painting, it almost looks like Jesus is looking right at her, and she's looking right at him. And I did that intentionally. I wanted young people, you know, 10, 12, 14 years old, to look at this, and maybe they will think he would come just for me. You know, you see that relationship between the two of them. Now I'm going to talk just briefly about my current projects and ones that I've just finished. In the last few years, I did 7 days of creation. This was commissioned by an anonymous donor who wants to put them in Adventist and Christian schools around North America. And many Adventist schools, perhaps even here in Milwaukee area, have sets of these. This is day one. I wanted to depict what would be in the Creator's mind as he's about to create our world. And so the only way I could think of doing that is by having equations that represent the laws of nature, symbols of things that to my mind are obviously planned and designed, symbols from physics, from chemistry, from nuclear, you know, the nuclear symbols, the DNA, which is astonishing, and any chemist who has studied this out will realize that something like that is very, very impossible to just spontaneously happen. Day two, the separation of Earth's atmosphere from the water. All the symbols in there represent the ingredients chemically of the oceans and the atmosphere, and some equations that represent gravity and hydrodynamics, things like that. These are all real equations, so I'm hoping students who are studying these things will recognize them. This is day three, separation of land and water, and also all botanical life. So you have symbols of photosynthesis, of the nitrogen cycle, various things that represent botany. Day four, I happened to be designing this when we had a solar eclipse that summer, which you might remember just from a few years ago, and that inspired this composition. So I decided to depict that. The symbols here are of the electromagnetic spectrum, Maxwell's equations, which deal with the electromagnetic spectrum, as well as gravity, and Einstein's equations of relativity and various other equations. Day five is my favorite, and I actually brought 2 copies of these that will be up on the stage to look at more closely after I'm done. Day five is all marine and bird life. And this, I wish I could claim complete originality here, but my friend Ed Guthrow had this idea years ago of day five, just having Jesus spinning around and all this life coming from his hand, and this gave me a chance to represent that. So, and by the way, we went to the teachers' convention in Chicago while I was working on this, and one of the teachers came up to me and said, you know, if you could add a clownfish and a blue tang, I don't know if you can see him from here, and Dude Crush, my kids would love it. So I added Dory and Nemo and Dude Crush to the painting. Day six, the creation of man. And this is the first time I've tried to depict this supernatural light around Adam. I couldn't think of how to show that he is being supernaturally created by God. And that's how I achieved that. You'll notice little anti-evolution statements. There's primates contemporary with the creation of Adam. I believe that God used many fascinating aspects of design, including economy of design. You know, you go to a museum, like Field Museum in Chicago, and they'll say, well, this similarity in structure means we evolved from primates. Could it be that the similarity in structure is because God is efficient in how he uses design? It works for monkeys and gorillas and apes. It also works for human beings. That doesn't mean we evolved from them. And so there are many aspects of design that to me are evidence of nature that are evidence of design. And then the Sabbath day, Adam and Eve with Jesus. And by the way, that little gorilla baby on the bottom right is looking at a butterfly. In real life, that gorilla baby is the baby of the mother in day six. Yes. The other project I'm working on is for Loma Linda Medical Center. And now this is my biggest project ever. And it's been in the works for 6 years. It's 12 of the healing miracles of Christ. Dick Hart, the president of Loma Linda, wanted this done for their new hospital. Some of you may know they built a new hospital over the last few years. It's much bigger than the twin round towers. It had to be built because of earthquake codes, but also they needed a bigger facility. And so there's a grand hallway in that hospital, and at least 9 of the 12 paintings will be in that hallway. There's only one hanging so far. I'm working on the fourth one. They have the first three, and I've got about 4.5 to 5 years to finish it, and that's all I'm working on right now. This is the first one. This is the resurrection of Jairus' daughter. And what's really unique about this, I don't know if you can tell from this is a little bit lighter than the original, but there is color flowing into her hand and arm, but it hasn't reached her face yet. So this is meant to portray that split second before she comes back to life. And Jairus is actually depicted in the painting I just finished of the woman who touched Jesus' garment, the hem of his garment, because they were on their way to Jairus' house when that miracle took place. And that was the third painting. This is the second one. This is the healing of the blind man, where Jesus rubbed clay and spittle in his eyes. And then he went and washed in the Pool of Siloam. And last but not least, this is our family. This is my daughter Bonnie and her husband Jake and their little boy Jack. These are about a year old, so they've grown a lot since then. But Patty insists that I include these in the show. This is Lauren and Tommy, Lauren Pop, now Lauren Green and Tommy, and their little girl Kit. And she's walking now, and she's just really amazing. And our son Daniel just married Kylie in the woods of the studio last year. And they don't have children yet, but they have dogs. So, and that's it. Now turn on the lights, if we could. Now, that is not a painting that I did. But I have it up there for a reason. I've talked to you about Harry Anderson and my connection with Harry. I have no idea what time it is because I don't see a clock here, or how long I've been going, but just a few more minutes. That's an illustration by Russ Harlan. And I mentioned that Harry Anderson, about 30 years ago, gave me his costume collection. It's going to be hard for you to hold this at the same time that I hold these costumes. Could you come up and hold this for me? Just hold it so they can hear me. This was one of Harry Anderson's costumes. It was used in the Bible Story series repeatedly. And when he gave me his costumes, I brought them home, and I realized that I recognized them from other artists, not just from Harry Anderson. And I came to the conclusion that during the production of the Bible Story series, these guys traded the costumes amongst each other. That's Russ Harlan. You'll find it from Clyde Provenshaw, from other artists that worked on these things, and of course, Harry Anderson. And this is that costume. I'd like somebody to come up and put this on. Could you come up? I'm almost to the point where I don't put Harry Anderson costumes on people anymore because some of them are starting to disintegrate a little bit. Now, do you recognize this from the Bible Story series? Harry made his own stuff. He sewed, he carved, he did all kinds of neat stuff, but he made the outfit for the high priest, and this is part of that outfit. All of his depictions of Jesus and disciples use this tunic, and I've been using the same tunic for the last 30 years. So it's probably 60 years old or more, and I've never washed it, so sometimes my models complain, but I don't want it to disintegrate. I need somebody really tall. Really, really tall. Didn't I hear there's a 6'6" person? Come on up. How am I doing on time? Okay. This was actually not from Harry Anderson. I have a small collection of movie costumes. This was from the 1959 movie, The Greatest Story Ever Told. And whoever the actor was very tall, because it drags on the ground even for tall models. But I love it because it's so rustic. Yeah. Don, would you come up here? We're gonna shift eras here, back to the Civil War for a moment. We had this tailored, made for Chet Dameron, Don's father. And Chet used to like to talk to student groups. And he would say, you know how tall Abraham Lincoln was? And they say, no. And he'd say, 6'4". You know how tall I am? 6'4". He would say, do you know what his boot size was? Lincoln was 14, Chet was 13. He'd say, do you know, I weigh 25 pounds more than Lincoln. Do you know why? And they'd all say, no, why? He's this, because I have Taco Bell. I need a, oh, yes, you need a hat. A genuine beaver hat. Oh, I did, yes. I need another guy. Who? Would you like to come up? And then I need about 3 young children. You'll like it. That's a lieutenant's coat. Oh, yes, good. Now, for the Loma Linda series, Patty is making many, many costumes for me. And these are some of them. And most of them are antique fabrics from France. So they're almost all hand-woven fabrics, some of them from the 1800s, some all the way back to the 1700s. I'm going to put that on you. Come around here. And then I think you might fit this one best. You might want to get your cameras ready. Did you put these on them? On the kids, yes. Now I need some big guys. Armin? This is a very accurate reproduction of what a Roman centurion would have worn at the time of Christ. It was made for reenactors. I don't think it's going to fit him. There you go. This is a reproduction of a Roman soldier's cloak. It's actually like a poncho. They slept in this. It was their raincoat. It was kept them warm in winter. So it was their sleeping bag. And then, let's see, who else? Could you come up? Is she sleeping? Is that okay? This is another Roman cloak. And more of a common soldier's helmet. Not that you're common or anything. It's just, and let's see. Okay. Do you feel strong today?
Yeah.
This is a reproduction of a Roman, typical Roman's Lyrica Segmentata, it's called. And this was made for a reenactor in London, England. And other way. Yeah. There you go. If it hurts, you can take it off. Okay. All right, can we gather together for a picture, maybe? Come in tight, and if anybody wants to take a picture, let's do that. Mm-hmm. They look pretty authentic. How's that feel? You know they wore this all day long. Okay, let's give them a round of applause. Thank you. Appreciate it. Let me help you. Well, I told you early on I just wanted to leave you with a little challenge. I know some of you are interested in art. Some of you young people have raised your hand to indicate that. Most of us, you know, I feel really blessed to have made a living as an artist. And it's not an easy road to take. I fortunately married somebody who's patient in that regard. And when young people come to me and say, what can I, you know, what do I have to do to be a successful artist? I say, marry somebody with a good job. Because Patty has a dietitian for this first 6 years, we really needed that income before children started coming. But even if you're not an artist in the way that I am, every one of us has a chance to, in a sense, paint a portrait of Jesus by the way we live our lives, by the way we interact with our family and our friends, we interact with our business colleagues and acquaintances, with our neighbors. We all have a chance to show the world what God is like by the way we reflect him. So in a sense, that is painting a portrait of Jesus every day of your life as you interact with people. And I want to challenge you to remember that as you go through your lives, to remember that we reflect God's character. We're here to show the world what God is like. And to me, it's the highest privilege we have. Number one, to share in the creative process. I think God gave us the gift of creativity. It's a special blessing for us personally and our own enjoyment, but also for the world. But we have a chance. And he asks us and uses us to reflect what he is like to the world around us. So think about that. You're all artists. You may not have known that before you came tonight, but that's what you are. You paint portraits of Jesus as you go through your lives. So thank you so much for inviting us. We're going to be around for a while. Sounds like we're going to have an ice cream social. And Patty will have prints and postcards to sign and things like that. And I'll be signing them. She'll be selling them. If you'd like to come up and get a closer look at the artwork that's here, you're welcome to. And thank you so much for being a wonderful audience. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. That was really awesome and really informative and inspiring on many levels. So we have a fellowship hall, which is downstairs. And if you don't know where that is, good luck, because it's kind of a maze in here. But no, you just keep on going downstairs, or you can ask me or someone that looks like they know where they're going. That's where our ice cream social is going to be. That's where our next part of the evening is going to be. So thank you, everybody, for coming. And why don't we just bow our heads as we are getting ready anyways to close the Sabbath. Sabbath is about 10, 15 more minutes. I'm not exactly sure. So let's bow our heads together. Lord, thank you so much again for this opportunity that you've given us to gather together, to hear Mr. Green, and to see how you've been able to take what you've blessed him with, the ability to paint, Lord, and use it as a spiritual gift to draw people closer to you. Continue to bless he and Patty on the journey that they're on, Lord, and their family, and we just thank you for them. And Lord, As we close the Sabbath, we just also thank you for Sabbath. We thank you for that day of rest that you've given us. And now as we are going to transition in a few minutes into Ice Cream Social, just be with us and bless our conversation, we pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Patty was thinking if there's a few minutes they could ask questions, but they're already dispersing, so that's fine.
Before you come down, gather up your Harry Anderson things to put back, and bring your computer down and give
okay.
it to me.
Okay. Okay. I'm really good. I'm really thirsty, though. I ran out of water.
There's water bottles downstairs.
Okay. I forgot to show this, the Harry Anderson one with that same, but oh well.
How come you have to do that abstract color thing behind?
If I paint on stark white canvas, your brain has like a light meter in it. I mean, it perceives how light.